today's research event. And today I'm going to talk about my PhD project. As the title says here, Reprogramming Schumann and Contemporary Piano Cycles. Okay, so what do I do exactly? I separate the Schumann and contemporary cycles to small pieces and rearrange them in an exclusive order. Well, it sounds a little bit ridiculous. Well, I understand, even after 2 years of doing this research, there are still some moments making me feel, wow, this is such a ridiculous idea. And believe me, there are not so many things out there that can be more scary than feeling this way in your PhD after getting transfer exam. But anyway, however, I managed to persuade myself that even though at the beginning it sounds a little bit fantastic, it is a viable approach. And as persuading ourselves is really more difficult than persuading others, so hopefully after 90 minutes you will be persuaded as well. So how did this ridiculous story start? Like all the ridiculous stories, it always have a very ordinary beginning. So 5 years ago, my mom came here visiting me, and I brought her to a concert in Barbican Center. And after hearing the Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto No. 1, I found her eyes were filled with tears. This is such a surprise to me because she has absolutely no Western music context and knowledge at all. And when I asked her, she insisted that it reminded her of a Chinese musical work, Yellow River. Well, to my ears, it's absolutely unbelievable to comprehend. And a few months earlier, I read a book called Crossing Paths, written by John Devereux, who is a well-known Schumann scholar. And in this book, he mentioned in the introductory his listening experience of Schumann's Symphony No. 1. He said about the two-thirds of the way of the first movement, it's the lower wind and the strings directly directs his mind to the Brahms Symphony No. 3. Well, he called it musical illusions. And he claimed that we ran the risk of conflating two distinct properties. But to my ears, this is not a risk. This is the adventure. And this is where everything starts. And in my research, it has a different name too. I call it imaginary listening. Okay. So primarily, imaginary listening is based on these far-fetched associations. So even though to professional musicians, such far-fetched associations may contain no logical sense at all, but they are not supposed to be overlooked. The sensory instincts originated from individual social experience, political background, educational context, and internal empathy guide the imaginations, deciding the logic of the imaginary listenings. To be more specific, the imaginary listenings are the personalized associations of every aspect of individual minds based on personal background, knowledge, and experiences, and awakened by the unique moments of musical stimulations, eventually connecting the most distinct pieces with a certain perspective of thought. In this reprogramming context, the imaginary listening is the primary basis, allowing us to enjoy the possibility of uniting two or more extremely different cycles as a whole. Undoubtedly, this is all about listening experiences. As I wrote for the first paragraph of my thesis, listening, rather than being passive perception, is a reactive art form in the musical realm. Tim Hodgkinson emphasizes listening in his book Holy Ghost, claiming that by embodying the traces of the listening of its maker or makers, music, in the moment that it sounds, is listening to itself, and I listen to it by becoming it. The immersive or even symbolic response imbues each listening with exclusive subjectiveness. In Hodgkinson's words, turns it to a unique and unrepeatable performance. The listener's professional ability is of little relevance, but their highly varied individualities serve to refine their imaginations. From this aspect, everyone's imaginary listening is unique. Nevertheless, it is worth to clarify that performers' imaginary listening is fundamentally different from a listener's one. In addition to the musical knowledge and professional skills, performers often formulate their imaginary listening subconsciously based upon performance. The countless time performers spend with an instrument or a specific work hugely influences their comprehension and imagination related to it, which contributes to the enlightening and unpredictable moments on the stage. Imaginary listening might strike the audience as an eccentric idea when it appears, but for performers, it is an outcome of repeated exercises and contemplations. In a nutshell, one is a sudden stimulation, the other is a result of digestion. So let's put it in a more understandable way. Performers can establish an intimate and special relationship with the piece they are working on, and composers, especially good composers, they are aware of that. According to Natasha Nolga's research, Schumann didn't stop Clara from only choosing a few pieces of Serenata to perform in her own creative way. Well, maybe this is just because he simply didn't have the ability to do it. Anyway, she is the wife and the mother of 8 children. What can you do about such a woman? However, interestingly, Clara Schumann's attempts of creative performance possess similarities with some of the approaches performers applied nowadays. Earlier in this January, I read a CD review from The Guardian, evaluating the new release of Bach's Well-Tempered Clavier, played by Piotr Andrzejewski, in which he selected 12 preludes and fugues from Book 2 and reordered them in his own program, as himself described, in a sequence of my own subjective choosing, based sometimes on key relationships that work naturally with one another, and other times on contrast, which seems to draw the pieces irresistibly together. The idea of playing these works in a specific order is to create a sense of drama suggestive of a cycle, 12 characters conversing, mirroring each other. Yet the first sentence of the review wrote, "Playing his own selection of pieces from Bach's monumental work may be heresy, but Andrzejewski's intelligence, lucidity, and joy is undeniable." Obviously, the reviewer appreciated his performance, but did not fully accept his rearrangement. Well, anyway, it is not difficult to perceive that performers nowadays are no longer satisfied with merely being a deliverer anymore. They endeavor to become a creator, to convey their own thoughts, stories, and philosophies of the world to the audiences through their performances. A super essential question floated up to the surface now. How do we do it? Yes, reprogramming. Of course, reprogramming is not the only way that can transform a performer from a deliverer to a creator, but it is certainly a possibility. And the reprogramming approach I'm exploring here is fundamentally different from Andrzejewski's one, because his approach is mostly based on performer's central thought and, based on tonal and technical relationships, and my one is based on performance central thought and logical narrative. Namely, I'm not feeling content with only creating innovative contrast in styles and peculiar connections. I want to tell a complete story. However, I must admit that initially, I was absolutely obsessed with creating extremely contrasting expressions. You must think I'm exaggerating here when I say the word extreme. How extreme it possibly could be? Well, okay, I will just give a very quick example here. Last year, I did 2 experimental concerts, and afterwards, many of my friends assumed I was out of my mind. That's because I did this. And then And then I realized afterwards that it is this answer that makes it not so cool anymore. I'm not saying something against the extremely contrasting expression here. I'm saying if we want to have it, then better have it for good reason. Naturally, when combining the two cycles composed in two different centuries, the most direct result is contrasting expression. Varying incessantly with characters and sensations, the contrasting expressions between Schumann and contemporary cycles instinctively draw comparisons in terms of fast-changing dynamics, musical gestures, and lyrical lines. It is inevitably related to performance approaches, which not only contributes to recognizing the contrasting expressions, but also reforms it. In other words, the contrasting expressions are relied partly on the composers and partly, probably on a larger proportion, on the performers. In my taxonomy graph, I have the contrasting expressions defined as such. Different musical parameters, which apparently create distinct acoustic effects from every aspect. Undoubtedly, the performers plays a significant role in this process, directly deciding in which way the distinct acoustic effects can be perceived by the audiences. Manipulating the dynamics, gestures, and lyrical layers, performers utilized their choices of physical movements, articulations, and control of the strings to delineate the musical characters they comprehend on the basis of the composer's indications. But respecting the composer's intentions does not limit the freedom of performers' explorations. On the contrary, it provides more impressiveness within the general context. For the real freedom is never the one without any restriction, but the one bears responsibility and control. The fact that contrasting expressions are largely dependent on the performance approaches suggests another trait. It can be observed simply by listening instinct without acknowledging the underlying connotation and background of the music. Practically, it is straightforward. By producing the aggressive and vertical sounds in Stockhausen I just played, the appearance of Kinderzinnen's gentle and expressive touch in itself becomes one of the most distinct contrasting expressions, requiring no more explanations. To some extent, it can be regarded as the empty pleasure to the ears, if it is indeed a pleasure. Meanwhile, the lyrical lines in Kinderzinnen also contradict with the multiple layers of dynamic suddenness in Stockhausen, alluding to two utterly different worlds. Nevertheless, after the concert, I found that I am not satisfied with mere contrasting expressions anymore. I want it to happen for a reason. In other words, it has to bear some more substantial meanings so that I can use the contrasting expressions as a handy tool to express what I, as a performer, really want to express. After all, the new element that generates the contrasting expressions are not inserted to the cycles randomly. They should serve performer's central thought. And otherwise, the reprogram would become a scattering collections of extremely different works rather than a complete integrity. Now I come across the most important thing we're talking about today, the performer's central thought. So what do I mean by the performance central thought in this reprogramming context? This reminds me of another question in my transfer exam this year. One of the examiner asked me, so is this reprogramming like an assembling process? You know, as if you have so many Lego pieces and you just build them up together as a construction. Well, I hesitated for a moment because I definitely sensed something dangerous in there. And then I took a brave move and gave them absolutely no. No, I said, it's more a writing process because what I have are not regular Lego pieces. It is my choice to shape the musical materials with my performing skills and to deliver a logical narrative thread with my conscious intention. Well, as I have already passed my exam, so I know they must buy my answer. But if you think carefully, there are still a lot of ambiguities in there. What can be recognized as a logical threat? And what is the performer's intention? better to use some actual examples to illustrate all the confusing terms here. Back in this May and June, I did two complete reprogram recordings. The first one I call it Carnival Eddie, consisting of Schumann Carnival and family photos, a piano cycles that composed by one of the PhD students from the Academy as well, Jeff King. And Schumann put all the different characters in Carnival, including spiritual figures existed in his mind, such as Floresta and Eusebius, and artistic figures in Italian comedy, such as Arlecchino and Piero, and also realistic figures such as Chopin, Chiarina representing Clara, and Estrina representing his ex-girlfriend Ernestine, and that is also why Clara never chose to play it. However, as the newest composition in this research, technically speaking, Family Photos bears no obvious resemblance with Schumann Carnival. Although both cycles are depicting various characters and musical scenes, the compositional ideas are not from the same root. So how to design a logical context to combine the two different cycles as a whole becomes a special step during the reprogramming process. My inspiration comes from my first impression on Family Photos. When I encountered this cycle for the first time, the bold intrusion and suddenly surprised me to an extreme. The decisive opening with energetic staccato notes and wide range of register, as you can see here, suggested an intrusive feeling at the very beginning of the cycle. Almost instinctively, I thought, why don't I use this special quality? Surely the two cycles are disparate, but they do not have to be identical, right? The contrast expressions can include all the musical parameters, harmony, rhythm, dynamics, texture, etc. And it also includes the characters, meanings, and styles. By interlacing those cycles from two centuries together, there are numerous contrasting expressions being generated simultaneously. Only when we appropriately utilize those connections and shape those contrasts with reasonable logic in order to achieve a multidimensional logic goal, so the contrasting expressions can truly possess their artistic values. From this aspect, contemporary cycles sharing many similarities with Schumann's peculiar musical approaches, including digressions, overlapping voices, quick alterations, and abstract wings, have the basics of the two to give a retrospective view of the Schumann, heightening through their angularity and sharpness, and finally to fuse the discrepancies by discovering the associations of certain perspectives. The time range of 200 years explores space to objectively realize the distinct and the kindred spirit, which remains as the underlying coherence concealed by the contrasting expressions. Today, I will just skip all the complicated exploration process and jump directly to my outcome. The first reprogram, I titled it as Carnival Eddie because I treat all the carnival characters as a wonderful illusion, a mirage which is too good to be true. And on the other hand, Family Photos plays the role of an intruder, constantly attempting to break the mirage and regain the rationality. Namely, the whole reprogram is a mental battle, a process of trying to take control of self-awareness. But unfortunately, sometimes, the more you struggle, the deeper you are. And this is also the central thought I want to convey through this reprogram. The whole thing starts from Carnival and ends with the last celebrity pieces of Carnival 2, which actually shows that the person who is immersed into the Carnival mirage simply refused to wake up. Eventually, the rational consciousness is defeated by the enjoyable mirage, surrendering to the exuberance and comfort of Carnival and rejecting to be sober as if we can never wake up someone who is pretending to be asleep. Although the two cycles are composed in different
humanity remains the same. People always believe in what they want to believe rather than what they ought to be. And to some extent, it is pathetic. The second reprogram, consisting of Schumann, Fantasy Stucki, and two Schoenberg cycles, Opus 11 and Opus 19, is not as scary as the first one. Fantasy Stucki carries fruitful imaginations and describes a fantastic journey towards a wonderland. With an indicated title of each piece, the cycle not only depicts the enchanting scenes of fantasy, but also provides imminent feelings, generating musical atmospheres with immortal, revolutionary, curious, and ruptures, and sometimes visionary sensations. I like Carnival Eddy, in which I applied the contemporary cycles as a representative of consciousness to battle against the carnival characters. Schoenberg's transformative musical language is placed in between of each fantasy in order to reinforce, underpin, or at some point, dwindle the distinct musical effects. As if someone is live streaming his afterthoughts, inspired by each single piece through this fantasy journey, and that's why I call it fantasy review. I always imagine this is a musical version of Alice in the Wonderland. And the listening experience begins by dropping into a rabbit hole, and we get to see the fantasy scenes as the scenes themselves, intervened by a third person's eyesight and afterthoughts. Okay. The reprogram finishes at the end of the song in Fantasy Stucki. In the coda, as you can see here, with the sudden turn of the last a few crazy lines, the joyful fantasy scenery disappears with no signs, and Alice falls back to the realistic world. I did this second reprogram recording after a month since I did the first one, and there was some extraordinary feeling which I didn't experience in my first recording. The silences. I realized the silence can be a super powerful weapon for a performer to shape the musical vibe in a reprogramming performance and deliver the central thoughts in a more convincing way. Comparing with Carnival Eddy, I intentionally control the silences between the pieces in Fantasy Review, categorized all the connections and include the silences as part of the general structures in order to exaggerate the musical atmosphere. It is not effortless as I have imagined, I have to say, as the silences are not mechanical rhythms that one can just follow with metronome like thoughtlessly. To be honest, even though I realize the importance and the role of designing silences, their importance is in the whole program still surpassed what I had imagined they would be at the very beginning. They give the space for the music to breathe and consequently makes the entire reprogram more an organic whole. As a performer, it gave me moments to digest my thoughts and feelings awakened by the former ones and blurred my mind of differentiating the performing styles between Schoenberg and Schumann, as if they are influencing each other to express a new, unexpected, and varied thought. Personally speaking, this whole recording experience was enjoyable. And I remember once the great Russian pianist Richter once said in his documentary, he said, "I just want to play something I enjoy. And if I enjoy it, the audience must do as well." Well, please don't misunderstand me here. I'm not saying I can play as good as Richter, of course. But as a performer, I believe the heart of sharing the enjoyable things with our audiences is the same. Now, let me briefly introduce you what you are going to hear in the next 1 hour. The title I gave to this third reprogram is Dreaming Kreisleriana, consisting of Schumann Kreisleriana and Jörg Biedermann Elf Human Rescue. Unlike the first two reprograms, this time I set Biedermann's contemporary piano cycle as a general context instead of Kreisleriana, dragging the music to a dreamy land right at the very beginning. I did this intentionally, not only because I don't want to go through the same process for the four times, but more importantly because the differences between the two cycles are huge, like in terms of composition. my responsibility to find a suitable context which can allow every pieces to blossom reasonably. Then all of a sudden, I thought, why don't I start this as a dream? After all sorts of weird things do happen in our dreams. And Whitman provides convenience for me in his cycles as well. The title of number 10 in the 11 Human Rest is literally Song in the Dream. However, with the almost violent high A hovering on the top constantly, there is one thing we can be definitely sure about. It is not going to be a peaceful dream. So it has every emotion we will experience in the real life. And after experiencing a lifetime, do we finally wake up at the end? Well, I don't want to spoil your listening experience. So after all, 1,000 people have 1,000 Hamlet. I will leave that question to you. So we PhD students often face a very simple but actually very tricky question. What is your project? In my first year presentation exam, one of the examiners was quite mean and asked me, are you just randomly inserting all those contemporary cycles into Schumann? Well, now, after a whole year of research, I finally could answer this question with full confidence. No, this is not about inserting, and this is not about reprogramming. This is all about telling. Telling the audiences with performers' reflections, thoughts, and understandings of the world. What we are doing is using all the musical materials and our professional skills as a toolbox to communicate. So the reprogramming approach revives the conventional repertoire and subverts the way we used to listen to it and gives new possibility to our listening experience. And it is in this experience we performers can find our doppelgangers, both as a deliverer and a creator. Well, thanks everyone. Hope that was not too tedious. Let's have 2 minutes short break and then I will bring you my dream impressor.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.